Hi, I'm Chuck Stout, curator at the Wings Over the Rockies Air and Space Museum, and today on Behind the Wings, we're going to talk about a Colorado film company that became one of the biggest airplane manufacturers in the 1920s, Alexander Aircraft. We'll compare two models of the Alexander Eaglerock and see some of the rapid advancements that happened in aviation in the 1920s. And then we'll talk to somebody who really knows a lot about these aircraft and their history.
In the early days, it was thought that every square inch of surface you could get would improve handling capabilities. As we'll see with the later model airplane, Al Mooney redesigned it and made it much more streamlined.
This one's gonna be cool. It's time to go behind the wings. Here at Wings Over the Rockies, we have more than 70 amazing aircraft and spacecraft in our historic World War II era hangar. Now, we're lucky enough to have not one, but two Alexander Eaglerocks that we're going to be able to look at today. Let's take a closer look. So we're here today with Brian Richardson, who is the secretary of the Colorado Aviation Historical Society. And Brian's going to be talking with us about the Alexander Eaglerock and Alexander Industries. Go back with me now to those thrilling days of yesteryear with the 1920s. There were no interstate highways. If people wanted to travel between cities, they'd ride the train. And airplanes were unreliable. And into that come the Alexander brothers, Don M. and J. Don Alexander. Two brothers, both named Don, and they both went by Don. They had a thriving film industry, and they wanted a better way to distribute their films, so they decided to use airplanes. Where do we go from there?
Well, actually, Chuck, the Alexander Film Company had a large sales force distributing throughout all the United States. They needed a better way to transport their film, so they had the brilliant idea of putting a salesman in an airplane. They checked with all of the manufacturers at the time around the country, and nobody believed that they wanted an order of 50 airplanes. So J. Don and his brother Don M. decided, well, if we can't buy airplanes, let's go ahead and build our own. The first airplane they came up with was somewhat dismal in performance, and a young man by the name of Al Mooney, 19 years old at the time, without a lot of formal education, became their lead engineer. And he designed the airplane you see behind us. This is the first production series they had. It was called the Longwing Eaglerock. It's called Longwing because it has a longer low wing and a shorter high wing. Interestingly enough, the wings are actually the same exact size. All the wing panels are 18 feet exactly. The difference you see in the bottom wing is because of the fuselage is 2 feet wider at the bottom. They found that the longer wing on the bottom gave them an advantage at high altitude. What that wing does is provide an extra cushion of air when it's close to the ground, which we now call ground effect.
The first several airplanes didn't work very well. Tell me a little bit about that if you can.
When Alexander decided to get into the flying business for salesmen, they looked around for an airplane that they could purchase and maybe copy. The first airplane they bought was a 1920 Laird Swallow. When it returned with their first pilot, Justin McEnany, who was the head salesman for the company, not a pilot, but he learned to fly for the company. On arrival, J. Don looked at it and said, it's nothing but a bunch of wires and wood. They also purchased four Longren biplanes that had been destined for the Navy. They were poor performers as well. That's when Al Mooney came along. Al Mooney realized the problems with the aircraft, apparent design flaws. Number 107 was the first airplane that they actually built. We call it the Al Mooney airplane. This is an example of what Al created.
Let's talk about some of the features that he put into this first Al Mooney Eaglerock.
Okay, great. Go check, well, why don't we start here with the propeller? The Alexander Company never manufactured their own props. They used a host of props, but predominantly it was the American Propeller Company. This is called a scimitar blade. You notice this engine is covered in a metal, whereas the rest of the airplane is fabric. This is hand hammered. The engine is a Curator OX5 90 horsepower engine, 8-cylinder, liquid cooled. One of the unique features on this airplane is that the Alexanders included an oil can with each airplane so that you could lubricate the rocker arms. They were externally lubricated, not internally like you find on most engines. This was the first power plant that Alexander used in almost all of their early airplanes simply because the US government built 17,000 of these for war training purposes during World War I. One of the other unique features to this airplane, they had a radiator. They incorporated a shutter system that was controlled from by the pilot in the cockpit with just a simple cable. But as they climbed and got to higher altitudes where the temperatures dropped, or with their flying in extreme conditions, they could close the shutters and keep the water warmer, and it preserved the operating integrity of the engine. Before we move along, I'd like to point out the landing gear system on this airplane. These are part of the early design features of the first 20, 25 Alexanders they built. They had a solid axle, it was called a straight axle, and the high pressure tires. One of the problems they ran into, as you well know, is in those days there weren't paved runways, not until the mid 30s or so. Al Mooney saw this as a problem. They'd had a couple of reports of airplanes in fields with high grass getting caught and flipping up on their nose because of that axle. So they designed a split axle, as you can see on the museum's other Eaglerock over here.
That's right. One of the things that's really important is that this is a very rare airplane, but we have two of them here at Wings Over the Rockies Museum. This is the older one, and we're going to go over and see the newer one, and you can see the improvements that they made in just a couple of short years. But as long as we're here, let's finish looking this one over.
One of the unique design features I wanted to point out on this wing, it's a rectangular wing, and it was improved with the later models. It uses flying wires and what we call landing wires. This is what gives the tension in the wing to keep it perfectly rigged. And you can see this is pretty taut. The pilot generally flew from the back seat. The forward cockpit, accessed by this small door, had a seat wide enough for two small people or one very large person. So moving back towards the tail, we have the elevator and rudder control cables that were external to the fuselage. You've got a simple handhold. In order to move the airplane on the ground, you just arm strong this thing, pick it up and move it around.
And one of the things that airplanes in the 20s had with the sod fields and so forth is a skid rather than a tailwheel. That would serve as a brake when you're trying to land in a shorter field.
That's exactly it. If you notice, there are no brakes on the front wheels. This would dig in and bring you to a stop pretty quickly. The tail section itself, the horizontal and vertical stabilizers are steel tube with fabric covered over, just as it is with the fuselage, and then stringers of wood and metal inside the elevators and the rudder. One unique feature you'll notice about this is the elephant ear rudder. In the early days, it was thought that every square inch of surface you could get for a control surface would improve handling capabilities. As we'll see with the later model airplane, Al Mooney redesigned it to do away with that and made it much more streamlined and much more attractive.
So Alexander Aircraft got cranked up and they're making lots of airplanes and business is good. And then tragedy struck. A devastating fire wiped out their entire factory in Inglewood and killed 11 workers. Following that fire, they moved to a 260-acre plot in Colorado Springs with its own airport, and business picked up and production resumed. So we were talking over at the older Eaglerock about the kind of progress that was made in just two short years. They didn't have model years. They would make incremental changes to the airplanes on the production line as they thought of them. So why don't you show us some of the differences between the original Eaglerocks and this, which is more or less the latest model, the last Eaglerock model that they made.
All right, Chuck, why don't we start at the front like we did the last time? Chuck, first thing you notice is the engine. We went from a V8 to a radial engine, no longer liquid cooled, it's air cooled, 9 cylinders producing about 300 horsepower. This model is a Lycoming. What differentiated the earlier Eaglerocks from these later A model Eaglerocks was the fact that they would put any engine that they could on these airplanes for you. You also notice the prop is no longer wood and it's no longer fixed pitch. This is a counterweighted steel bladed propeller. This made it particular to this engine. Also, you'll notice the landing gear is different. It's no longer a straight axle like we discussed earlier because of the problems they had with it. You now have the semi-A-frame there, different kind of shock system. These wheels also had brakes, another improvement.
So you mentioned that Hershey bar-shaped wing on the early Eaglerocks. Let's look at the tips on this one.
In the A-series, the major difference in the wings was the fact they added a center section. And these are indeed called the A-series or center section Eaglerocks. It's about 6 feet of additional wing. They got rid of the old worn truss style framing with 2 points and went to a 4-point system, which gave it much greater strength. And it did away with all of the structural problems they had in the earlier Eaglerocks. Another feature to notice is the rounded wing tips, both top and bottom. This was more streamlined, and it also provided a safety feature if they had a ground loop or a hard turn and the wing dipped down and caught the ground. It made it easier to change. Chuck, another unique design feature of this as they advanced in their construction was the addition of windshields. Prior to that, you had to wear goggles, leather helmet. They still would with these airplanes, but this just relieved you from having to have the pressure of a goggle on your face the whole time. Another advancement was a streamlining of the rudder. You can see this rudder is no longer that bulbous elephant ear shape. It's more streamlined. At this point in time, airports are improving. They had tailwheels rather than the skid we saw on the other version. And as you pointed out to me earlier, a unique feature is the color difference in the logo here. The first 40 or 50 were hand-painted, but it was so time-consuming, they needed to come up with a better system. Lastly, I'd like to point out the tail number. Just as on the other one, this is NC. NC stood for National. That was the U.S. registration code. And C was a special letter that manufacturers wanted to have. It meant it was used for commercial purposes, and it could be flown internationally. Mm-hmm. Not every airplane could.
This is great. We've been able to see how in just two short years, there have been so many changes in the same basic model of aircraft. So from 1927 to 1929, more Eaglerocks were made than any other kind of airplane in the whole country. And then when the stock market crashed, things got tough. So by 1931, the company's in trouble. What happened then?
In August of 1932, they declared bankruptcy on the aircraft portion of their business. They continued in the film industry for a number of years. In fact, the legacy is still there in Colorado Springs. And that kind of brings us to an end on the Eaglerock saga. They were leaders at one time, but the Depression, like so many others, spelled doom.
Well, Brian, this has been fascinating, and I've learned a lot that I didn't know before. I really appreciate you being with us, and thanks for being behind the wings.
Thanks, Chuck.
We couldn't cover everything, so please leave your comments and questions under the video, and we'll get to as many as we can. And come down to the museum and see these things. This is the end of the video, and if you're a subscriber, thanks very much. And if you're not a subscriber, hey, please just subscribe already. I got a lot of airplanes to see. Bye-bye.